So it gives me great pleasure to introduce you to David Hassenzahl.
Thank you, Laura. Good afternoon. I'm glad to see so many of you staying around. I know I'm between you and the reception, which is always sort of a dangerous place to be. I added yesterday afternoon, after yesterday's reception actually, I added another line to my title for this presentation. It was going to be School of Sustainability and the Environment and the Eaton Hall campus. I added this continuing a Chatham tradition because I realized after talking with several of you that the sorts of things that I'm excited about doing and that sustainability does is in fact right along the traditions that Chatham has been following and came up several times in this last conversation as well. That is this interdisciplinary approach to problem solving, not getting tied into disciplinary thinking. So I was very excited to hear the conversation from people from a variety of different time periods at Chatham have the same experience of a focus on interdisciplinarity and not getting stuck in a narrow way of thinking. Because that's where we have become in academia. In a lot of places, it is primarily disciplinary and very narrowly disciplinary. And what sustainability tries to do is broaden out beyond that. Sustainability is a pretty simple concept. It's consistent with a lot of religious worldviews. It's consistent with a lot of historical worldviews. It's what the Greek philosophers were studying 3,000 years ago. It is how do we live a good life? How do we meet the needs of our generations without compromising the ability of future generations to have those same opportunities, to have as high a quality of life as we have now? That's what sustainability is all about. There are three pieces of sustainability. This is what really differentiates it from environmental studies programs over the past 30 or 40 years. Environment is one piece of sustainability. The other two pieces are social justice, are the things we're doing to protect the environment, also being fair to a broad set of people, and economic development, are the things we're doing to try to preserve the environment, undermining our opportunity to have economic opportunities. And so I use an example very often of the first job I had. I was working for a pulp and paper mill, and there was a guy there who ran the power plant for the pulp and paper mill who was always complaining about, oh, those environmentalists, he used a bad word before environmentalist, I won't repeat here, oh, those environmentalists, I can't stand them. Yet he went out and figured out a way to take the gases that came off of our burner, and rather than just let them go to the atmosphere and waste all that heat, he turned them over on top of the paper that was coming out of the back end of the pulp machine and dried it out more quickly. He figured out a way to do sustainability. He was using less energy to get the same amount done with less. There are two key perspectives associated with sustainability. One is interdisciplinary thinking. You can't do all three of these things if you're thinking as an economist or just thinking as an ecologist or just thinking in some other disciplinary field. We need to integrate and get the appropriate sources of knowledge to solve the sorts of problems that we're facing. And the other is systems thinking, thinking about how an action in one place impacts actions in a lot of other places around the region, around the state, around the country, around the globe. So what are the things we do here? How do they impact other people and other environments in other places? And it also continues the tradition of Rachel Carson. This is exactly what she was doing. She is known in some areas as mostly being anti-pesticide, but from reading her work, that's to me not what she was about. That was the particular instance she was excited about, but she was interested in how does our use of pesticides impact ecosystems in other places? How does it reduce our opportunity to have economic development in other places? So she, I found, if you read her carefully, is not anti-pesticide. She was in favor of pesticides in certain applications. She was in favor of thinking carefully about how we use them, though. That really has committed in a significant way to the environment. We already heard that Chatham is the greenest school in Pittsburgh, but sustainability and environment is one of three mission statements. I would claim that included in sustainability are the other two pieces of mission statement as well. I think they're both very important. We have a green residence hall on campus. President Berezoni was one of the founders and first signatories to the Campus Climate Commitment, which is a significant national effort to think about how can we as universities reduce our impact on the environment. What can we do, rather than just try to teach and research about it, what can we do to demonstrate how it can be done well? And there are lots of little things that have happened on this campus. And if you look all over the campus, you'll see these things. For those of you who participate in the planting event each May, that is now done with local compost. There's low VOC paints that are used. If you went to the other building, the East Side building, there's very green lighting that's been done there. The green machines a lot of you have probably ridden in. There's solar. The lighting has been improved on this campus as well. And we have an arboretum here, which interestingly is one thing that Chatham shares with UNLV, believe it or not, University of Nevada, Las Vegas, is an arboretum. We have a lot of variety of trees there. Eaton Hall, I don't know how much you have heard about it already in various different publications. This was a piece of property that was used to provide an opportunity for women in the Pittsburgh area to have a chance to recuperate, to get away from the blue-collar life in Pittsburgh and spend some time relaxing and recovering in a very beautiful environment. In 2008, the Eaton Hall Foundation gave this property after some amount of negotiation with Chatham, inspired by Chatham's commitment both to women and the environment, which were two of the major goals of the Eaton Hall Foundation, and its founder, Sebastian Mueller, decided to give this property to Chatham to build this school on. So Chatham saw the opportunity to take this from a farm. Originally the thought was to make it a sustainable farm, but now that's one of our missions, and it's going to be a sustainable campus. Trying to think about how can we improve opportunities for the region, educational opportunities, policy opportunities, science opportunities. And so some time was spent before I arrived here thinking about how to do this and decided to use this as a place to make a school of sustainability in the environment where students and faculty, I should add to this slide, can develop solutions to 22nd century challenges. We're no longer thinking about 21st century challenges. We're a tenth of the way through that already. We need to think about the next, about my great-grandchildren. What's it going to be like for them? And we want to make this a living and learning community. So we're going to live there, we're going to figure out how to do things better there, and we're going to do it in a way that we hope will attract people from a variety of different backgrounds and interests, not just those who traditionally would be interested in environmental issues. We're going to focus on community, we're going to focus on academics, we're going to focus on the built environment, so making sure that what we build there, as Dr. Berezoni mentioned, is positive. That is, not only are we not going to try to minimize our negative impact, we're going to try to make a positive impact on the land. We're going to try to restore it, and also the natural environment. And you will see sustainability is one of the highest demand fields amongst undergraduate and graduate students. We have increasingly students who come in to undergraduate programs because they want to study the environment and they want to think about sustainability. I know when I entered as a freshman, even though I ended up majoring in environmental science, I didn't really even know there was an environmental science degree to be had. High school students now know this. They understand this. They want to study it. I presented a little bit about the school at an international conference on Monday, and I had a student from Ohio. She's a junior at a school in Ohio, a college in Ohio, said, "Are you going to have programs ready for me? Because I want to come there." So there is huge student demand. There's employer demand, which is at least as important. When I was running the Department of Environmental Studies at the University of Nevada, Las Vegas, I put together a board, an advisory board. I said, what do you need my students to do? On my board was a major Bechtel contractor. Bechtel does a lot of stuff at the Nevada test site. I had a person who managed public lands for Southern Nevada. Most of Southern Nevada is owned by the federal government. I had people who were in the private sector in town. I had a guy who was the sustainability coordinator for MGM Resorts. I said, what do you guys need? They said, I need you to train students in sustainability. I said, okay, well, what does that mean? They said, I need you to figure out what's to train our students in for sustainability. Employers know they want sustainability. They're not sure what it is. It's up to us to define that for them.